Hello, my name is Nathan Johanning. I work for the University of Illinois Extension, and we're here today to talk about no-till transplanting. I get a lot of questions about transplanting, especially no-till transplanting, working with cover crops and other limited tillage systems. So I wanted to take a little bit of time to talk about a no-till transplanter, some specific things you need to look for, and some pros and cons of different ways you can set up a transplanter to allow it to no-till, in this case, into wheat stubble or any other non-tilled and/or cover crop scenario. So to start off with, there's a couple of main things that you need. The first thing is you need a tractor adequate to handle this. If you're looking to purchase one, I say at least a 50 horse or greater tractor. You also need something because of the length of a transplanter and some of the weight. You need to make sure that it has something that has the ability to add weight to the front of it or is adequately balanced. So that way you have plenty of weight on the front end of your tractor whenever you're picking up the transplanter, especially whenever the tank is full of water and you have weight on the back. So moving on to the transplanter, this is a 3-point hitch mounted implement. The main things you want to look for to start off with is you need some kind of a no-till coulter. So here you can see we have this is a bubble style coulter. I actually prefer either this or a wavy coulter. A lot of times we use an 8-wave coulter, which is a fairly wide wavy coulter. To me, that wavy coulter works even better at loosening the soil in that trench, because remember, you're trying to prepare that slot for the shoe of that transplanter to ride in. The next thing we have here is we have a subsoiler tube. So this is just a small ripper shank that basically goes down about the depth of the shoe, about 6 inches or so, and opens up the soil and helps to loosen it up. I've seen various models. Some have that, some don't. But I do think that is a good addition, especially in heavier soils if it's a little drier. Sometimes a good coulter in the front will do a lot of good, but that tooth in harder soils can help to loosen things up a little bit more. Next, moving back on the transplanter, the next and probably one of the most important things of any of it is double disc openers. So there's two discs that are pointed together, and those will roll as you go through the soil, and basically that cuts and removes any final residue that is right in front of that shoe. If you didn't have that there, the shoe that transplanter would want to grab and drag on any material that wouldn't be cut before. And as you can see, even though we've cut a pretty good trench here, we still have some residue, and all it takes is a little bit of it to drag, and then that just causes all kinds of problems. You get more of a plowing effect rather than an opening and closing effect. From there, going back, the next thing that's a little different is we have flat packing wheels rather than the traditional packing wheels that are curved up. The flat packing wheels put more down pressure on the soil, and in a no-till situation, we don't need the curved action is for tilled soils where we're trying to pull that loose soil in. We don't necessarily need that action, but we need more down pressure on those back wheels. So a flat packing wheel is also really important to that system. The last thing that you need is some weight on the back. So in this case, in this model that we have, actually comes with a weight bracket that will support a 5-gallon bucket. We have this, in this case, full of concrete. So we have a fairly heavy weight, somewhere around probably 75 to 100 pounds on the back end of it. I've seen other growers that have mounted a bracket to put one or two suitcase weights, tractor weights on. But in the bottom line is that you need some weight on the back. That gives you even consistent down pressure on those closing wheels, because that's what you really need to get that soil to close back in around those plants. So today we are actually no-till transplanting some pumpkins into wheat stubble. So I want to take this chance, now that we've talked about the mechanism of a no-till transplanter and things to look at, what are some applications for that? How can we make use of that, and why would we? First off, of course, soil health is huge, and there's been a lot of research showing that as we can limit tillage, we're benefiting our soil and the health of our soil. So that's certainly one reason to incorporate no-till tactics into your production system. As far as transplanting, in this case, we are transplanting pumpkin plants. It gives us a head start because we can, in the area we're at in southern Illinois, we can actually harvest our wheat and then set a live pumpkin plant and get a pumpkin crop yet this same year and kind of double crop that system. Some advantages in pumpkins and all crops to consider is having any residue, whether it be a rye cover crop or any cover crop or wheat stubble, is that residue in that untilled soil allows for a lot firmer working conditions for any field applications you need to make. In this case, we've talked about pumpkins, but I've no-tilled tomatoes, peppers, some of the coal crops, any various number of things that you would transplant in a conventional tillage scenario. A lot of cases you can use a no-till system in as well. The nice thing with field work is a untilled soil has more structure to it. So in the event that you have a large rain, no different than what we did here last week, had a 5-inch rain. And shortly after that, in a no-tilled scenario with having this residue and the firmer soil, you can get out into the field a lot easier. In the case of pumpkins specifically, or any crops growing on the ground, any extra residue you have helps to prevent soil splash, so that gives you cleaner fruit and better harvesting conditions, especially whenever you have a crop, especially say something like cucumbers, that's harvested every other day and you need to harvest rain or shine. You have a lot better field conditions to be working in and less soil to deal with on fruit. So those are some considerations and ways that we could use no-till. I think it's applicable in many systems, whether it be a cover crop system or just a no-till without a cover crop. But I think it has a lot of benefits that can play into your crop production system. And with the technology and some of the mechanisms we have on a machine like this, it allows us to very successfully transplant even into a seed bed that hasn't been finely tilled and prepared. So this has been a little overview of no-till transplanting. With any adventure on the farm, whether it be big or small, there's always little tweaks and things you're going to need to do to make it work for your soils. One of the things in closing I always try to do is make sure that this machine is running as you set it up and adjust the top link. Make sure it's running as level as possible, so that way you're getting good action from your no-till coulter and subsoiler, but also making sure your drive wheel is down on the ground and making sure you're getting good closing pressure. Even with this, which is a new machine, we've made some tweaks and different adjustments to make it perform like we would like. So if you're going into this starting off, give yourself some trial run and allow some time to make some adjustments, look at the system, how it's working, and tweak it to where you're happy with how it's performing. Overall, I think this is a great system. It has a lot of opportunities to help advance some conservation tillage practices in our fruit and vegetable crops. So if you have any other questions or comments, I'd be happy, you feel free to reach out to my contact information, and we'd be happy to help you further.